All right, with that, welcome to AIOS 2021. We are starting with the session, and the session is about misdiagnosis in glaucoma. Are we turning a blind eye to the real problem? That's the topic we are going to discuss. Okay. I'll quickly hand over the session to our chairperson, Dr. Deepak Mishra. May I request Dr. Deepak Mishra to please chair the session? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening to all the speakers and delegates. This IC come general GP is planned for the pupil or the doctors who are, whether we are going to miss our common practice, means whatever the investigation is there and at which place are the things where we can go wrong initially or sometimes by the workload or anywhere to detect whatever the things or the investigations are important for the glaucoma and where we miss the things. With that, we have all the things which is important in the diagnosis of even diagnosis and screening of glaucoma. What was the problem we face in the gonioscopy or the common mistakes done? Even how can we minimize the error during the tonometry? What are the artifacts in the visual field and how can we interpret the visual field correctly? Then the ocular nerve head examination and the OCT artifacts. With these facts, I would like to invite my first speaker, Dr. Manish Singh. He will be telling us what are gonioscopy, common mistakes, and how we can improve the skill of the gonioscopy. Dr. Manish, please.
Yeah, I think it's visible.
Yeah. Yes, Dr. Manish, it's visible. Please go ahead. All the best.
So thank you, Dr. Deepak, and for this opportunity. And I think it's a very interesting presentation, the common mistakes on gonioscopy. So we have always been presenting about gonioscopy, but this was a nice opportunity to discuss what are the mistakes that can happen on gonioscopy. So one of the important things what we have seen that we give up too soon with gonioscopy. Like any technique, gonioscopy is also a technique which needs time to master. So we have to give effort. For example, if we take a case of, say, learning a capsular excis. Whenever we started doing a capsular excis in patients, when we started learning cataract, we had cases where we had runaway excis or we were not able to perform the excis. But if we never stopped doing excis. Similarly with gonioscopy, like any other technique, like endoscopy, ophthalmoscopy and all, we have to give time to learn this technique. But once you have done that, it gives you a lot of information in managing your glaucoma patients. The choice of the lens also is extremely important. If you want to learn a 2-mirror or a 3-mirror is good enough because it gives you a good fixation. So you can see the structures properly. You can identify the structure properly. But once you have mastered the technique, we should always try to switch to a 4-mirror gonioscope. And there are multiple reasons for it. To see why the gonioscopy in India is still not popular. One reason I personally believe is the gonioscope itself. Most of us have been trained using a 2-mirror or 3-mirror. And what happens that when you're using a 2-mirror, 3-mirror, you need to use this coupling gel. You apply it on the eye. So the whole thing takes time. Then it becomes messy for the patient. It causes blurring of the vision. So overall, the gonioscopy procedure is actually a time-consuming procedure. A lot of what happens in a busy practitioner, whether you're in a government sector or a private sector, a lot of time you tend to avoid doing gonioscopy. But once you switch to 4-mirror, it is very quick, very comfortable, no need for any coupling gel. There are 4-mirror, don't need to rotate the mirror. You will see you start doing more and more gonioscopy. Also, the lighting is extremely important. Like for example, this is a case where we are doing both abstination tonometry and gonioscopy in just 1 minute. You can see it's 1 minute video. So basically the point to highlight here is that with a 4-mirror gonioscopy doesn't take a lot of time. You have already put a paracan drop. You have stained the cornea. Now you're checking the pressure in right eye. Then you're checking the pressure in the other eye. Once you have checked the pressure, your OPD assistant can just switch off the light. Now this is a darkened room. It's not going to be totally dark, but with a reduced illumination. Now use the illumination of your slit lamp also. You can see up, down, right, left, and you can see all the four angles. So basically, with a very little effort and very little time, you can see do the gonoscopy in both the eyes. So correct illumination is important. You can see in this case, when you're seeing the angle with the bright light, the angle is appearing open. But when you have reduced the light, you can see the angle is closed. So as we all know, in bright light, it causes meiosis. So you should reduce the illumination. Maybe a 2x2 millimeter slit should be used so that the light is falling only on the angle and not on the pupil, so that the meiosis induced opening of the angle is not there and you get the correct assessment. This is another case where you see the angle is closed. We are using a reduced illumination and the light is falling only on the angle. The angle you can see very well, no structures can be seen. Now, once we increase the illumination, you can see once we increase the illumination, the angle is now open. So this is the mistake we often do. We are doing a slit lamp in a bright illumination and we wrongly diagnose them as a case of open angle glaucoma. This is a patient, you can see the centration of the gonoscope is very important. If the gonoscope is not centered, you can see air is entering from the side and that can lead to problem in visibility. This is another patient, you can see we are having issue with glare of time when you're doing gonoscopy. Especially you have seen students, they say they can't see because of the glaring. So you should always have oblique illumination and reduced light and the glaring will not be there and the structure will be better appreciated. So these are a few common tips we should be using to avoid any wrong diagnosis during gonoscopy. Also incorrect lens placement. You can see over too much of pressure can lead to these DM folds and can lead to false opening of the angle. So pressure is also very important. Another are certain patient-related factors. For example, uncooperative patient. You should explain the patient what you're doing. If you have not explained it and you suddenly put a lens, patient will become apprehensive, he'll squeeze the eye. So always explain the patient, then you will gain the confidence of the patient. Correct identification of these structures is also important. Whether you see from above, down or below, upward, try to see the structures. You can see this grayish ceribody band followed by the white stairs spur, then the pigmented trabecular meshwork and the anterotrabecular meshwork. What I always suggest students that have some pictures of open angle from Google or from textbooks on a mobile phone. And when you're seeing the patient, you try to compare it with what you have been seeing in your textbook. Then you can better appreciate these structures. In case you want to locate the Solby's line and you're not able to see the pearly white line, you can use the corneal wedge, thin slit. You can see the point where anterior and posterior portion of the corneal wedge is meeting. That is the Solby's line because this is the end of the Descemet membrane. So the light from the anterior and posterior portion of the cornea meets here. Again, over-reliance of pigmentation, especially I've seen a lot of young ophthalmologists when they are doing gonoscopy, they are trying to look for the pigmented trabecular meshwork. If the trabecular meshwork is non-pigmented, they assume that the trabecular meshwork is not there and they decide that probably it's a closed angle. But remember, in young patients, a lot of time there will be no pigmentation of trabecular meshwork. In these cases, if you can see here, you can see the multiple iris processes. Now, iris processes is a clear indication that it's the open angle. So even if you don't have a pigmented trabecular meshwork, try to look for other structures like iris processes. You can use a corneal wedge to locate the Solby's line. Sometimes normal vessels and abnormal vessels can be difficult to differentiate. Always remember the abnormal vessels are very fine. They have branching. They move, start from the iris, they cross the trabecular meshwork and they branch over the angle. On the other hand, normal vessels are generally single, they are much thicker and they will not have branching. Iris processes also needs to be differentiated from these points, synechia. Iris processes are fine finger-like processes and they are multiple in number and they are seen in open angle. For example, this case you can see between the processes, you can see the ciliary body, you can see the scleral spur and you can see the trabecular meshwork. On the other hand, when you see synechia, like point synechia, they generally are triangular in shape and they will have some amount of stoma involved in this. So this is where you can differentiate an iris process from the synechia. Also for initial training, if you have someone teacher, you can train you great, or else you can use gonio pictures on an iPad or your phone to help. Sometimes we do, we assume these pigmented trabecular meshwork as a So epigmentous Solby's line as a trabecular meshwork. And for example, if you see this case, it is appearing to be an open angle. But when you do a indentation gonioscopy, you see what was appearing as an open angle was actually a closed angle, and the actual trabecular meshwork is coming out. So this is another importance of using indentation gonioscopy. You can compress and you can see the structures behind the iris. This is another case where you can see the trabecular meshwork is pigmented and the Solby's line is also pigmented. So you need to differentiate. Trabecular meshwork generally has a more uniform pigmentation compared to Solby's line, which is more patchy in pigmentation. Don't use grading scheme because it can be very confusing. Like recently I had a patient where it was written grade 3. Now grade 3 in a skis means closed and grade 3 in a Schaffer means open. So don't mention grade, just write the structure which you can see in each quadrant before and after compression or with a dim light and a bright light, so that if anyone else is also seeing the patient, he can correlate that what structures you have seen. And most important thing is practice. Gonioscopy, like any other thing, like doing a rexis, making a tunnel or indirect ophthalmoscopy, is just you need practice. There are a lot of good books. There's a very good website, thegonioscopy.org. Just go see the pictures, see patients every day and try to compare. And this is the best way to learn gonioscopy. To conclude, I'll say gonioscopy is essential for the glaucoma patient. Of all the newer investigation like the AS-OCT uveum, gonioscopy is still the gold standard. And when possible, try to switch to indentation gonioscopy using a 4-mirror gonoscope. You will realize you will be doing many, many more gonioscopies. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Manish, for the wonderful lecture. Before we, I will call my next speaker, would like to take one comment from Sumita, ma'am. Ma'am, your one tip, how to minimize the error. Although Manish has covered each and everything beautifully, but since he at end told us that more and more practice, and you are the one who is having the
that is only one point. I agree. You have to make a lot of practice, all the students, because they fear, they somehow don't like to do gonioscopy. I don't know why, but still then they think it takes time and they don't practice it very much. So it is always best to make so many cases so that only they can know. It is easier to put the 3-mirror and with viscofluid and it will not shift. And they are easy to do it with. But after that also, they have to switch to the 4-mirror because that is required. And in this our scenario, Indian scenario, lots of angle closure patients are being missed. And the peculiar thing about the angle closure is that after one or two attack, the patient is blind. Suddenly you see one and he doesn't follow up. Then after 1 year, the patient is totally blind. That is the main disadvantage of angle closure glaucoma.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Now I would like to invite our next speaker, Dr. Rita Das. She will be going to give us some tips how for the optic nerve head evaluation. Rita, ma'am, please.
Am I audible? My screen is visible?
Yes, yes, you're audible and your screen is visible. Please go ahead, Dr. Rita.
Coming to optic disc examination, all of us know optic disc and retinal nerve fiber layer assessment and documentation are very vital for diagnosis and monitoring of glaucoma. And clinical and scientific evidence suggests that optic nerve head and retinal nerve fiber layer changes occur before the standard visual field loss. In ocular hypertension retinal study, the first endpoint achieved was more often in the optic disc than the visual field in both treated group and in the observation group. So how do we examine? It can be examined with direct ophthalmoscope, but preferably we advocate with a slit lamp biomicroscope using 90 diopter or a 78 diopter lens. And the photograph can be taken for the documentation purpose and imaging techniques. Commonly, the optical coherence tomography is done. And what are the common entities that can result in confusion while evaluating a glaucomatous optic disc? It may be physiological because there is a great overlap between normal and the abnormal variant. Normal physiological variation in the cup, in the neuroretinal limb, or in the peripapillary area of the retina can occur, which can be confused with glaucoma, or glaucoma can be misdiagnosed. Or there are developmental anomalies like optic disc split or coloboma that can be confused with glaucoma, or glaucoma can be missed. And non-glaucomatous optic atrophy, like here it's a post-papillary optic atrophy that can be confused with glaucoma. Either there will be overdiagnosis, or we are missing something which is more dangerous because the cup is not more, so that we miss the finding. Seeing the pallor, sometimes people miss the finding, and we are missing some devastating conditions. So one should be very careful. So a systemic evaluation of the optic nerve is always important, not to miss the diagnosis of glaucoma or not to overdiagnose it. So what to look for in optic nerve? As usual, it's the optic disc size first, then cup disc ratio, and most important is the neuroretinal limb and the nerve fiber layer defect, disc hemorrhage, and the vascular pattern and the peripapillary atrophy. And it should be done in every visit. And coming to the cup disc ratio, the suspicion of glaucoma occurs when the ratio exceeds more than 0.7, because it is seen only in 10% of the population. Not that always 0.7 is glaucomatous, but suspicion should arise. And the difference between the two eyes is most important, because glaucoma is a disease of asymmetry. When the asymmetry is more than 0.2, which is seen only in 1% of the population, and particularly in a small optic disc. I repeat the term small optic disc, because in a small optic disc, even 0.4 cupping is abnormal. In this case, in the right eye, we had a small optic disc, and the cupping is almost 0.75, and the inferior rim loss with a last recipient nerve fiber layer defect with a disc hemorrhage. But in the left eye, it's only 0.4 cupping. So if one is examining only one eye, then in a small optic disc, so very high chance we'll miss it. So always examine both the eyes, compare both the eyes, and be careful in small optic disc particularly. And this is also a small optic disc, and here there is pallor. Always when we see pallor, we think it's a non-glaucomatous optic atrophy. But when we see both the eyes, compare both the eyes, and take a proper history and do a proper examination, these patients presented to us with diminished vision in the right eye. And she gave a history of severe headache, vomiting twice, and she was given some intravenous injection in the local setup. So when we examined carefully, it was found the pressure was in the 30s in the right eye, in the left eye it was 22. And this patient, after careful gonioscopy, it was found there was 360 degree angle closure case of PACG, and there is intermittent angle closure, and it is a case of primary angle closure glaucoma. So one has to see both the eyes. And pallor can occur in case of glaucoma in primary angle closure attack is there. So one should be very careful, examine systematically, and comprehensive eye examination is a must. And coming to the neuroretinal rim, we all know the ISNP pattern is followed in 83% of cases. The inferior rim is thickest, followed by the superior rim, because the arcuate fibers are there, and most thinnest is the temporal rim. But in small optic disc, always there is high chance one may miss. And this, there may be deviation in the ISNP pattern, but in the small optic disc, one should be very careful. The rim loss, it's a shallow cupping, but the rim is totally lost. There is not with a very big nerve fiber layer defect. But when in a busy OPD without dilatation, sometimes people see, they miss this finding. So always examine in a dilated people not to miss these findings. Because we know glaucoma is irreversible cause of blindness, so one should see in a dilated people not to miss all these findings, and if possible in a red-free light. And neuroretinal limb loss can be focal like a notch, or it may be diffuse. In a diffuse case, sometimes there is suscerization or shallow cupping. Sometimes this, with very advanced case also missed. This case is a small optic disc with a shallow cupping, but the total inferior rim is lost with peripapillary atrophy and with a large NFL defect. So when there is shallow cupping, small optic disc, one must be careful. So I emphasize the point to examine in dilated people and with a 90 diopter lens, not with the direct ophthalmoscope. And one should try to examine in a green light, that is red-free light. to appreciate this nerve fiber layer defect. And this picture is not very good, but what I want to emphasize, this patient came to us for a routine follow-up presbyopic correction, but here in the right eye, there is already advanced glaucoma and both inferior and superior rim loss with the corresponding visual field defects and changes in the OCT also. But in the left eye, it's a 0.75. This is a small optic disc. It's a 0.75 cup also, there were changes, but it's not showing in the OCT picture. So one should see both the eyes and be very careful in a small optic disc. And only cupping is not important. Pais has given the concept of disc damage likelihood ratio, so that emphasis will be given to the neuroretinal limb. What is this disc damage likelihood ratio? That is the rim width in the thinnest part. Suppose this is 0.2 divided by the diameter of the optic disc. So if it's 0.2 and the whole diameter is 1, then it becomes 0.2. So it is a rim width, thinnest rim width divided by the diameter of the optic disc. That is more important because we give emphasis to the neuroretinal rim. And when there is a loss in one sector, suppose the sector becomes 0, then it becomes 0. Then we find out how much is the extent of the damage. And coming to the vascular changes, observe the vascular changes very carefully. The wire netting, the overpass of the vessel, the bearing of the circumlinear vessels, the nodularization of the vessels. All these things should be looked into very carefully. Then nerve fiber layer defect, the best examined with the red field light to the fluorescence brightness and visibility of the retinal blood vessels is become very prominent. It may be slit light, waste paper defect, or diffuse slit light defect. If they're smaller than the size, the diameter of the blood vessel, then it should be omitted. And coming to the retinal nerve fiber layer loss, they may be focal or they may be diffuse like this. In a large optic disc, this may be missed. There is a diffuse loss in the enlarged cupping along with a diffuse NFL defect. So in a large disc also, some might think this is a large optic disc, large cup. So this might be missed. So this is also asymmetry between the two eyes. If one examines this eye and hurriedly examines this eye, so one may think this is a normal eye and one may miss this increased cupping, the nerve fiber layer thinning and the NFL defect. So examine two eyes and be very careful for the asymmetry and the NFL defect. And accordingly, you will plan for your examination and treatment. And one should be careful in the myopic patients. We get, all of us know, we get the parapapillary atrophy, like betazone atrophy is more important in case of glaucoma. But in myopia cases, the very high chance of missing out the glaucoma because the rim size is here, not the outside thing. So one should follow the blood vessels and there is shallow cupping. So, and the peripapillary atrophy is there. So misjudging the disc and misjudging the area of neuroretinal rim damage and the NFL defect. So one should be very careful in case of myopia also. And coming to the disc hemorrhage, this is a splinter separate hemorrhage and reported by Duns. And this indicates the signs of activity. And we find these cases usually with the NTG. Whenever there is a disc hemorrhage, maybe in case of early glaucoma and advanced glaucoma, we find it. And either there is already the nerve fiber layer defect or there is high chance it will occur in future. So one should be more aggressive in the treatment plan. But it's not seen in such advanced glaucomas, but here we have one case with a disc hemorrhage. So most of the times the disc hemorrhage, small disc hemorrhage or in abnormal position, one should find out what are the other causes, whether the patient is diabetic or not, or hypertensive or not, DRBO or not, PVD is there or not, other causes one should find out. But photographs should be taken in each visit better. Because sometimes in clinical examination, small disc hemorrhages are missed. And always differentiate between glaucomatous from the non-glaucomatous optic disc because pallor is more than cupping. It's often difficult for experienced surgeons. Also, they sometimes miss out this finding. And here is another case. I've given one in the left eye. Here, the optic disc cupping is very much normal with a healthy nerve fiber layer. This patient is known to me with a family history. His father was glaucomatous. His brother and sister, they were glaucomatous. So that's why he was under follow-up. The right eye, he had an inferior rim thinning, which was shown in OCT also, and in the superior aqueous scotoma. but in the left eye is visual field towards the central scotoma because of the peripapillary CNVM. But the optic disc is normal. But sometimes what we do when we see a CNVM or such big lesion, we concentrate on the lesion only, not on the optic disc. So this eye might be missed. So there is a high risk case, family history, and the IOP was raised. There is structural changes here in the field also correlating, but we sometimes concentrate on these things and we miss the finding in the other eye and we miss the diagnosis totally and we delay the treatment. So examine the eye as a total, do a systematic examination, be it systematic evaluation is always important. So we always follow this five rule. Observe the scleral limb to know the size of the optic disc. The rim is important. And retinal nerve fiber layer analysis, region of peripapillary atrophy and retinal and optic disc hemorrhage. In the systematic way, if you go, we'll not miss out the findings. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Mukherjee.
Thank you, ma'am, for such an elaborative talk. Meanwhile, I will switch over to next talk, which Dr. Tutul ma'am to comment something on the optic nerve examination. Kindly unmute yourself. Dr. Tutul, kindly unmute yourself.
Dr. Tutul, we can't hear you. I will request you to unmute yourself. I'll quickly send you.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Please go ahead.
Yeah. First of all, Dr. Rita, it's an excellent talk. I mean, because pointing out small discs, because really we always miss small discs, right? And this is number one. And number two, you have mentioned about DDLS, disc damage likelihood scale. I think it would be better if you all follow DDLS also. It's a little bit difficult to follow. I have a video, it is available on online on DDLS. It is recommended by George Spade. So you can see that video. And they say this is, when it is 0.1 millimeter difference, is a neuroretinal rim, right? So this is very important. What's the small rim loss? I mean, this one should be diagnosed. And this is the point that you miss this. And when it could be like this, the cup is very small, but cup is eccentric cup. You have seen that example in your presentation, that cup is missing, right? There's no cup. So that means cup is very small, but no neuroretinal limb at all. That means the severe defect, but because the small cup, we always think that it is a big defect. So what you have said, that is small disc can always compare about the two discs. Number three, you have seen your drawing, but perhaps I missed it, that you haven't mentioned, better to draw it. I think drawing is the must, and if you draw it, it can replace this photograph, because your patient may be, when you see that's a cataract patient, right? So because in the early stage, if you draw and if you just have your drawing with you, you yourself can find out, you don't have to go for OCT or anything. You can see that how CD ratio or rim loss or vessel changes are happening. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, next talk is mine. It's on how to minimize the errors in the tonometry. There is no financial interest. IOP measurement, we all know what is tonometry and what are the tonometers are the instrument which can be used to measure the IOP. This is the whole chart or all either the equipments we have available to measure the IOP, starting from the ancient manometry to the indentation, then applanation, again applanation into the non-contact, then contact. In contact two, we have with fixed areas and we have the tonometers with fixed force. Then we have the combination of both applanation and indentation. After that, we have rebound contour matching tonometers. So in due course of time, we have developed, scientists have developed many, many tonometers. To just know or have some tonometer which is going to be ideal tonometer for a glaucoma expert, or we can check the pressure in all the those cases. So whatever the misleading readings can be, it can be because of the three things. One is because of the tonometer, whatever the tonometer we are using and what are the problem in that tonometer. Someone is having, most common is the choice of the tonometer, which type of tonometer is used in which type of the cornea, whether it is used suitable for it or not. Then calibration is again an important parameter which we have to do regularly to calibrate your machine. And third important one is the maintenance. Maintenance is important because it is not like a one-time gadget that you have taken, but you have to be taken care. Otherwise, any problem in calibration and maintenance can lead to the false reading. And these false reading will reflect it again. Another thing which can have is because of the patient condition. Whatever the patient condition, we have to choose a proper tonometer due to the patient. Sometimes we get the false reading or misreading because of the cooperation and non-cooperation of the patient. Sometimes we didn't understand or find out the specific tonometers which can be used in the patient cornea condition, like if it is scar, then different type of tonometer is required, opaque, then different, thin, thick, whatever then. And one thing is important, which I am daily telling with all of my friends and resident, that first counsel and give small knowledge what the procedure you are going. If you are going to take and do the plenation, then first explain. When the patient know the whole procedure, they can have better cooperate and with you and even for the gadget, and there is less chances of misleading. So counseling and knowledge of the procedure is very important for the patient point of view. So we have to explain them each and everything in advance. Third, whatever we are as an observer or the ophthalmologist, we can do some errors in the, we can have some errors from our side too. That may be because of the skill, like Dr. Manish just mentioned, that gonioscopy is a learned skill. Similarly, the tonometry is also a learned skill. The way you are doing to measure IOP or the take as much as you have do the plenation tonometer or with another tonometers, you are more perfect on them. Second, you have to know the tonometer knowledge, which type of tonometer is your and how you can use it perfectly. Apart from that, there are also some biasing or the human errors which is expected for the calibration or something else. But nowadays, most of the equipments already have their calibration tips given in there. So important two parameters which is important for ophthalmologist is skill and the knowledge of the tonometer. And third things, which are the, there are the many factors which are associated with elevation of the IOP. Like whatever the postural changes are there, Valsalva manual, heart blinking, some of the common anesthetics used if you are going to take or do the glaucoma screening in the children, whether which type of anesthesia they have been given, use of tobacco or another thing, and even sometimes steroid also. You have to know whether to take the proper history. So these are the some conditions which have known to associated with high IOP. Before measuring or taking IOP, we have to know or ask the proper history for that. Similarly, there are the conditions which are known for the low IOP, means there is a falsely low IOP. That may be because of the after the taking of the prolonged exercise, alcohol, sometimes in cases of pregnancy, it is there. And we have to know that all the anesthetics except ketamine and succinylcholine is usually going to reduce the IOP. So if you are going to check IOP of anyone, then keep these things in your mind, back of the mind. Now I am coming to some common tonometers available and the process or the things where we go wrong or there is misleading by us during the tonometry. This is the COTS tonometer, almost most common type of the indentation tonometer. I'm skipping the principle. One of the thing or the problem in the tonometer is we don't explain the technique. And this is the important way that you have to ask the patient to look straight. That is the important thing in the technique, that patient should look straight so that you can put proper weight on the sclera. sometimes we use this convergent table or the graph. So you have to paste this table or graph or known that which type of scale reading is there and how many grams you have put. So accordingly, what is the IOP are the things. Initially, it is very difficult to remember. So it is advisable that you can put it here on your table where you are going to take it. Also, you know that in eyes with high ocular rigidity, there is chances of high false IOP. Like if you are doing cases in the hyperopic or long standing glaucoma, then there is chances of false eye. And in cases of meiotic or the RD surgery, in which there is chances of false IOP when the rigidity is known. So these two parameters is important. And again, calibration. I initially insisted that you have to calibrate. There is calibration plate is there, ring is there, where a metal you can push and ensure that plunger should reach the scale zero before you move to next. Applanation tonometer, Goldman applanation tonometer. This is the ideal tonometer till that it's evolved. And the basic errors in there is the placing the proper mire. What is the important is that you have to place the mires, inner side of the mire coincide with the inner side of the lower mires with upper, and the height of the mires are almost equal. So initially we can get the thick mires like this. This thick mires can be because of the overstaining. You can get the thin mires because of the understaining. Sometimes we get this type of mire. Only one mire is seen. And sometimes we get this type of mire. If this is the mire, it means your plunger is on the extreme. You have to move in this direction so that these mires, this is the upper half, which are you are seeing half. And if you move your joystick towards the this direction, then you can get the proper mire. And similarly, in this type of mire where you are getting unequal, it means your joystick should move down so that this mire will get whatever the mire you get, it will be the complete. And at the time of the endpoint, you can even feel the pulsation in the mire stool. And sometimes due to the overpressure of the cornea, if you have moved joystick firmly on the cornea, you will get a rigid and fixed mires like this. So in that case, you have to move the joystick slightly towards yourself. Apart from that, there is a different types of reasons why there is falsely low IOP. I already explained you the cornea and the fluorescein. And one of the important thing is the with the rule astigmatism. So whenever you are going to do the applanation tonometry in cases of refractive error or anything, just go for the and check for the astigmatism too, which type of astigmatism is having. And sometimes false IOP, false high IOP can be because of the same conditions. And here the false IOP is reported with the against the rule astigmatism. Calibration is again the important point. You have to put the weight and look and calibrate it. Oftenly, I advise it will be done at least monthly to your applanation tonometer. This is a Perkins tonometer. It is handheld type of a handheld type of applanation tonometer. And here it is useful for the patient which are infant, children are bedridden, because you have seen it is very advantage is that it doesn't require slit lamp, so you can move it. Mackenmark tonometer, yes, here is the tonometer which you can use in the scarred, irregular or the edematous corneas, or sometimes ask when you have to take the IOP on the soft contact lenses. So these are the conditions which I have explained previously, that you have to know which type of cornea, which tonometer is used are good. If you are going to do a applanation tonometry on scarred or edematous cornea, but obviously you will get the wrong readings. For that, we have Mackenmark tonometers. Tonopen is slightly same, but a handheld type of Mackenmark, but it overestimates the low IOP. This is the inherited problem of the machine. We have to know that whatever is there, here it is having the digital display, so there is no human calculation error. NCT, again, NCT is most commonly used for the screening purpose. And when you are going, you have to know what are the error will can be do. One of the important is the patient position and the distance between the eye and ear jet. Till by the time you are going to move, then the patient will shift his chin and head position forward or backward. And with by these patient position movement of chin, we can get falsely errors in the tonometer. ORA is something which can be worked on the principle of corneal hysteresis, and this corneal hysteresis graph give us these four things, which is the corrected IOP, gold compensated IOP, corneal compensated IOP, resistance and hysteresis. Since it is weakly correlated with CCT, appellation tonometer is have a strong correlation with CCT, but this ORAs have very weak correlation with CCT. So it can be used in cases of high refractive error or anywhere where axial length is more, because it is unassociated with the type of refractive error. So if you are going to measure an high refractive error or where CCT values are different or changing, so we can use this tonometer. Eye care is a rebound tonometer. Here the common placement error is the placement of the tonometer. You have to see that the upper plunger is placed on the forehead according to position, so that when we fire and this plunger, which is a magnetic plunger, goes and strike, come back to the probe, it will follows at the center of the cornea. So this is very much important that you know where to place the tonometer in cases of rebound tonometer. In DCT, it is a third generation tonometer, work on the principles of contour matching. Here, it is important that it eliminates most of the things which is inherited problems of the cornea or tonometer, is that it such as influences of the corneal and the rigidity. And I am moving. That's why it is again a tonometer which is not affected by the central corneal thickness. IOP telemetry is a device which is used for the 24-hour monitoring for those who it is some sort of 24-hour DV. Here, each and everything is done by the machine itself. It takes the reading for every 5 minutes or 30 seconds, every 30 seconds for 5 minutes, and then the 24-hour tracing is drawn, and we can calculate by this. This is a common chart which you can use, which type of tonometer is good and accurate for which type of the cornea. With this, I am coming to my conclusion. Still, the gold standard is Goldman appellation tonometry, but for the irregular corneas, use rebound or pneumatic for contact and intraocular gases too. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Deepak. I'll give you a little breather. You just finished your presentation. So if anyone is having any questions, you can ask Dr. Deepak right now.
I think I will invite next.
Meanwhile, I would request our next speaker, Dr. Sumita, to please start sharing her screen.
Good evening, and at the outset, let me thank Dr. Deepak for giving me this opportunity. So my topic is perimetry misinterpretation. Actually, it is a very vast topic, and if you go systematically seeing one parameter by next another parameter, you may not make any mistake, but it is very difficult to do so in a busy clinic. So there are usually some misinterpretations, and I don't have any fine disclosure to make. The visual field defect, whenever we see any defect in the printout, then it may be due to real defect or it may be due to artifact. Artifact is also very common in case of perimetry because it is a machine oriented thing. And if the defect is real, that is means that it is due to any pathological change, then that pathological change may be glaucomatous or non-glaucomatous, like in retina condition, like in where any visual pathway, any defect is there, then that can come in the visual printout. So some of the common artifacts are that if there is papillary constriction, if the papillary constriction is there, then that can produce ring scotoma-like defect. But if we dilate the pupil, then this will go away. So main thing is that if the pupil is less than 2.5 millimeter, then we have to dilate it. And important thing is that we have to mention it in the perimetry. And so subsequent examination should be done with at least in that perimeter, so that there will not be any variation in the sensitivity.
Another condition is ptosis or dermatocalysis. All those things can produce defect which can mimic glaucoma, but that is obvious if you look at the face of the patient. And you can know that it has to be taped, and if you tape, the defect vanishes. And one of the common artifact is the rim artifact due to the rim of the trial lens. But trick is that we have to use the full aperture trial lens, and lens should be placed close to the eye without touching the eyelashes. Sometimes if the patient takes away his head during the perimetry because the chair height is not adequate for the patient or something, then that may also produce the rim artifact, and lens should be centered also properly. But the rim artifact is very common if there is high hyperopic correction is used, and whenever two lenses are used instead of one lens. And trick, how will you know that there is a rim artifact? Because it will produce the effect like this, and this one we can confuse with the arcuate defect. So the trick is that there is sharp depression in the peripheral point. You can notice here from the 25, 24 like that, it has already become zero and even less than zero. So this would give us the clue that there is a rim artifact. It's not due to peripheral glaucomatous defect. And nowadays, in the COVID era, another defect we are getting, that is the mask artifact, because the patients are wearing the COVID mask. And if they are not getting proper sealed, then there is fogging of the trial frame. And as a result, particularly, you can mark there is inferior nasal field defect is there due to the mask effect. Then another thing is that we have to correctly put the refraction of the patient. So this patient was myopic, and it was mentioned that he was using -4 diopter lens. But in the meantime, before the next test, he has undergone LASIK, and his refractive error has become zero. So he doesn't require any glass now. If we do the perimetry using that same -4, then there will be lots of difference. But when we correct it to the emmetropia like without any glass, then the MD will come back to the -1, and it is almost normal. So we have to not only correctly enter the refractive change, we have to also verify that it is the same refraction we are doing whenever the next test. Then another thing of that, there is cloverly pattern or reverse cloverly pattern. This will come, this will be obvious from the grayscale alone. This is one of the very useful comment in the grayscale. So these 4 points are tested at the beginning of the test. So if the patient is attentive during these points, then these points will be showing some sensitivity. But after that, the patient, due to fatigue or due to inattentiveness, is not responding. So peripheral points will be black. Sometimes the perimetry starts with the patient, stays with the patient when the test begins, and subsequently he moves away. By that time also, the patient loses his attention and makes the error. So reverse is the reverse cloverly. This happens when the patient does not know that test has started. So he fails to respond to these 4 points. And subsequently, when he knows that the test has started, he starts responding very well, and the peripheral points are becoming giving sensitivity. So another mistake we may make the pattern deviation and total deviation. If there is any mismatch, then total deviation normally should show more defect points, more depressed points than the pattern deviation, because the machine filters the general reduction of sensitivity and gives us the pattern deviation. But if the pattern deviation is showing so many depressed points, and the total deviation is not showing much, then that means the patient is trigger happy. And if you see the full printout, then you can see there is lots of wild scotoma, and there is fixation losses. False positive is much more, and the glaucoma hemiplegia is also showing that there is a abnormally high sensitivity. And another thing, important thing we have to know, that in a known glaucoma patient, if the pattern standard deviation started improving, then that is an ominous sign, because whenever the patient is normal, the PST is small. Gradually, when the scotoma deepens, the PST will become abnormal, abnormal, and more abnormal. But towards the end stage, again, it will start decreasing. And that is not a good sign. That is a sign that patient is approaching towards the end stage of the glaucoma, because most of the points have become zero, and there is not much difference between the 2 points. That certain neuroophthalmic condition also can give us problem. And this hereditary optic neuropathies, which may produce field defect, can be confusing. And what differentiates them from normotensive glaucoma is the typical family history and early age of onset and reduced visual acuity, because glaucoma, visual acuity is almost latent towards the very advanced stage, and there is color vision defect will be there, and the defect will typically be centrocecal defect. And the pallor of the neuroretinal rim is the important thing here, because in the glaucoma, the neuroretinal rim is not pale. It is notched or something, but it is not pale. And the bitemporal field loss is usually due to chiasmal lesion. This will be obvious if we set aside the two fields side by side and they are respecting the cortical midline. So we can know that it is due to the compression by the pituitary tumor. So any defect which respects the cortical midline should give us the hint that it is a neurological defect. And this patient, you can see, if you only see the right eye, you can see and you can confuse that it can be due to the superior arcuate defect. But if you mark, then it is respecting the cortical midline. If you see the left eye also, then you can see the left eye is also showing cross central visual field defect. So this is an example of ipsilateral central scotoma and the contralateral quadrantanopia defect. So by joining the two, we can think that it is a junctional scotoma. It indicates that there is compressive lesion, which we may miss if we see only on the one eye. Then another of these patients also similarly, we can confuse this with the superior arcuate scotoma because it is in the arcuate region and it is there is a scotoma. But if you mark minutely, then you can see that it is falling short at the cortical midline, that is respecting the cortical midline. So if we see the second eye also, the trick was that the patient was pseudo-exfoliation. So by pseudo-exfoliation and perimetry defect, we can already jump to the diagnosis that, it is the field defect due to glaucoma. But if we see the other eye is also similarly showing the defect, and left eye also is superior temporal quadrantanopia. So if we see both the defect side by side, then we can know it is an homonymous defect. And the left homonymous superior quadrantanopia, it is suggestive of suprachiasmal lesion. This we can know only if we see both the fields together and not jump to the conclusion by seeing only one eye and the pseudo-exfoliation. And from this we have to know that we have to see both the fields together to recognize a pattern. And important thing is here that we have to keep the printout of the right eye to the right side and left eye to the left side, unlike the disc changes or something in which we keep the right eye to the left. And this is also suspicious because there is gross asymmetry of the field changes in spite of the normal optic, similar optic disc changes. So if there is any discrepancy, then any gross asymmetry between the fields and the discrepancy between the two things, then we should suspect that something is playing the background. So field changes should always correlate with the disc appearance. Otherwise, we have to order for a neurological investigation. And anterior ischemic optic neuropathy may closely mimic the glaucomatous defect, but it is producing altitudinal defect and it can be thought of as the arcuate defect. But if we see the fundus picture, in the fundus picture we'll look that the disc is edematous and this will please the diagnosis. But once the disc edema subsides, it's really very difficult to diagnose the ischemic optic neuropathy from the glaucomatous patient. And history will help here. We can, ischemic optic neuropathy will be sudden loss of vision, painless loss of vision. In case of glaucoma, it is not so, it is a gradual process. So this, we have to also think and keep in mind that it may be due to AION. Then another thing is that, suppose we know some patient, he is visiting us regularly and suddenly he describes that he is a sudden diminution of vision in the one of the eyes. So that means that there is something else is happening other than glaucoma or alongside the glaucoma, because glaucoma will not make the patient immune to other diseases. In this case, the AION has developed in the non-glaucoma patient. So any change in the course of the disease is suspicious. Here the patient is suddenly developing some field defect and that is due to the change in the pathology. So we have to suspect the neurological condition when the scotoma that obeys the vertical midline, because glaucoma always obeys the horizontal midline due to the peculiar arrangement of the retinal nerve fibers. A field defect which appears suddenly is unlikely glaucoma, and purely central scotoma with preservation of the peripheral field also give a suspicion that neurological condition may be there. And rapid deterioration of visual field in spite of good IOP control should also give us the red warning. And pilus is not correlating with the degree of copying, and pil deficit not consistent with the glaucomatous pattern also should give a suspicion. And if there is gross asymmetry between the pil, I mean, in spite of the similar optic disc change also, give us the clue that it may be some neurological condition. And we should not also forget about the retina, because retinal condition, choroidal scars also can produce pil defects, which will mimic glaucoma. In this type of patients, here there are choroidal scars which are iatrogenic and produced by the PRP. And here the choroidal scars are due to inflammatory, due to the sarcoidosis or any toxoplasmosis or any condition. And this will produce the pil defect like glaucoma. So never give the diagnosis by just looking at the perimetry. You may be wrong. You have to look at the clinical picture also. And certain vessel occlusive diseases like BRBO or BRAO also can produce pil defects, which are exactly like glaucoma. But once you dilate the pupil and see the condition, also the PRP, also the retinitis pigmentosa, the condition becomes very clear. So dilated fundus examination is very much essential. And without doing that, by seeing only the perimetry, we should not give the report. Otherwise, we will be proven wrong. So do not overlook the central visual field in the early glaucoma, because traditionally it was thought that the central visual field was affected towards the end of the glaucoma, and glaucoma only affects the peripheral visual field at the beginning of the disease. The glaucomatous damage to the macula can occur early in the glaucoma stages. Some may present with the central visual field defect early in the glaucoma. But paracentral scotoma can be overlooked if we do only the 24-2 or 30-2, because the central 10 degree is very less represented by this 24-2. Only 12 points are there in the central 10 degree field. So, but 10-2 field has 68 points in that area, and you can mark here it is very closely spaced and only 2 degree point density is there. So we can detect the glaucomatous defect early. So if there is a single defect in the central most 4 points, we have to add a 10-2 so that we will not miss the early paracentral scotoma. And Sita, in the Jais machine, the Sita faster program has come out with the 24-2C, and the test has got 10 additional test points within the central 10 degree fixation. And these points are located, these are not symmetric. They are located in the area which are usually affected in the glaucoma. And there is Madam Tutul will tell us more detailly about this thing, because he has extensively researched in this particular segment. And there is substantial agreement for identifying the central visual field defect between the 24-2. So we should not miss the paracentral scotoma. Concession for learning effect, because it is very much a very difficult process and it is very much subjective. So we have to give concession for the learning effect, and some patients are having a very long learning effect, and decisions should never be taken based on a single field. The field has to be reliable and reproducible. Otherwise, it is cannot be taken into consideration. And glaucomatous field usually follows a pattern due to the typical arrangement, either arcuate or paracentral or nasal defect. Anywhere any defect is not glaucomatous, and interpretation should always follow the clinical diagnosis. Isolating the perimetry, we will not give the diagnosis properly. So avoid missed and misdiagnosis in glaucoma by carefully monitoring. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Tutul, ma'am, can you say something regarding ma'am's presentation? Are you finding it? As you have published research and new articles too on 24 and 10-2.
Thank you, Sumita, for citing our paper. Number one, it is not only the central 4 points, the central 12 points in the central 10 degree, number one. And number two is, if you, look, our paper is very much accepted, very much appreciated that we have done for the HFA3, but still, if you ask me as a clinician, I would like to do HFA3, 24-2 and 10-2. I know it's a very difficult, for patient, for clinician, for time and everything, but 10-2 is such a good thing. So for that reason, Professor Linda Zangwill will kill me if I say science like this. But even, I mean, most of us, we are now thinking that HFA 3 perhaps is the best option, but still in my clinic, I would like to prefer to do 10-2. Number two, we have another paper, I think Sumita, whether you have noticed, that is the central most visual field defect, right? The central 4 points. But I think apart from central 4 points, that is that 12 points, I mean, they are very important. And some of them are saying that 16, I mean, central 10 degrees, 16 points, central 16 points. Apart from central visual field defect, and central visual field defect research, I think, whole concept of glaucoma will be changed, right? Previously, what you have said, that previously we thought that peripheral defect is the most important and central visual field remain at last, right? I mean, it will be remain. It is not true. Even in the earliest stage, central visual field can be affected. And that is the most dangerous thing, especially normotensive glaucoma. And what happens in the disc hemorrhage or other things, we sometimes overlook it, right? 2 points are there, apart from central visual field defect. You have mentioned about the pseudo-exfoliation. Now, if the pseudo-exfoliation is there, I mean, as a clinician, what is our opinion? That even if the glaucoma is not there, if the one eye is pseudo-exfoliated, we should check the patient routinely, because pseudo-exfoliated eye will be converted glaucomatous, there's more chance. And if the both eyes are pseudo-exfoliated, so, I mean, whether is the neurological defect is there, we have to differentiate it from the neurological defect, and we should follow up this patient. And third point regarding AIUN, again, is neurological defects are there, because pallid will be definitely much more than, neurotilum loss, right? So from pallor, we can differentiate between the two types of thing. That is, one is neurological loss and it's a glaucomatous loss. Second, even it the both the eyes, I mean, having the AIUN is not very common. So in that way also, we can use the one eye, the typical altitudinal defect, and other eye is not altitudinal defect. And what is the neurological, profile of that patient. By that way, we can also differentiate the two patients, right?
Thank you, ma'am. With this, I would like to invite you again for your talk on the most fascinating gadget in our glaucoma investigation tool, OCT. Younger generations are more fond of doing OCT than gonio or aplanation.
Yes. I have to, you just help me, because I really don't know how to share the, I just want to share my...
Ma'am, at bottom at bottom, you will find there is a list of mute, video, chat, and after that there is screen share option with green. Up arrow is there.
Share screen, right?
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Please,
I have... to find out my, Can you see now?
Is it? Dr. Tutul, we can't see your screen.
Just.
PPT has to be opened.
PPT, I have opened my PPT.
Okay, try sharing the screen again. Just go on the green spot. Just click it on that again.
Can you see my screen?
No. Just try typing Alt and S together. Alt-S together.
Alt
and S together at the same time.
Can you see? No.
No, we can't see. Then
don't. First, you open your PPT, then share again.
Okay. I'm just opening my PPT. I'm sorry, I'm taking so much time. Sorry, I'm sorry about it.
It's totally fine. We all are getting habitual to this new virtual world. That's totally all right, Dr. Tutul. Nothing to worry. Yes, we can see your screen now.
Now great, we can great. See, madam. Yes. Okay, go for full screen. Great, it's coming.
Okay, so I'm now going to start. First of all, we are now this evening, we are talking about OCT artifacts. And at the outset, I would like to offer my thanks to Dr. Deepak for giving me this opportunity. I must say that I'm a visual field person, and also I know something about optic disc from Professor George Spade. And Deepak has given me the task to discuss about OCT. I don't know how I can do it right. So I'm trying my best. Now, overlooking OCT artifacts can lead to false negative diagnosis of patients who actually have glaucometer's damage, or conversely lead to false positive diagnosis of individual without glaucoma. Now, what are the artifacts? It could be software artifacts, misidentification of retinal layers, incomplete segmentation error, complete segmentation failure, mirror artifact, that is inverted artifact, and degraded image scan. It could be operator-related artifact, that is cartridge artifact, out-of-register artifact, and in fact, it could be patient-related artifact, that is blink artifact, off-center artifact, motion artifact, segmentation shift. Now, just I want to say again about patient-dependent factors, that is age, pupil size, tear film quality, media opacities, eye movements, blinking, epiretinal membrane, myopia, increased axial length, abnormal optic nerve insertion, and parapapillary atrophy. Now, OCT, that's the reference database limitations are there. If there is a less than 1%, machine will tell you red color. And this is, if it is between 1 to 5%, then it's a yellow color, that is a borderline. If the green, that is 5 to 95%. And it is more than 95%, it gives you white color. Please see, then 5% is common between green and borderline, right? So here is 5%, and also in green also 5%. So there can be a chance of misdiagnosis. Now please remember, glaucoma is a clinical disease, not a statistical diagnosis. So beware of red disease, and note that the green disease is not always good. So it's a very common red and green disease. Red and green disease are color used by OCT manufacturers to indicate whether various parameters of a patient are within normal limits compared to a normative database. Red disease refers to a false positive disease diagnosis, and green disease refers to a false negative diagnosis. Results may also be erroneous, as the normative database used by manufacturers do not account for variation related to high refractive error, the pediatric age group, and race. Now, scan quality and imaging artifact. Quality of scan are essential for accurate misinterpretation. Imaging artifacts are common, one in every three scans, and can dramatically impact the ability to detect disease or its progression. Concurrent disease is also common. Non-glaucometer changes to the optic nerve head, RNFL, GCIPL can simulate or mask glaucometer changes. Please don't blindly trust the numbers or fall in love with the color. Systematically and qualitatively scrutinize each and every scan to ensure quality and accuracy. Now, poor signal strength is a danger. It could lead to red disease. Weak scan can dramatically underestimate RNFL thickness. A 25% reduction in superior quadrant RNFL thickness with a decrease in signal strength from 10 to 6. If you see the first one, you can find that this is 10, signal strength 10 by 10, and the number is 105 in the superior quadrant. If it is 8 by 10, number reduced to 95 in the superior quadrant. And if it is a 6 by 10, number reduced to 81 in superior quadrant. So it's a 25% reduction. So accurate segmentation depends upon adequate signal strength. You can improve it by dilating or by thin artificial tear improves scan quality. But please remember the manufacturer's signal index, that is MSI, for each machine or for every machine, it is different, right? In three machines, we have seen that it's a three different MSI. So please note that, and then you just your printout. Red disease can happen due to opacity, cataract, corneal scarring, dry eye, vitreous opacity can interfere with this, particularly when superior and inferior temporal near optic nerve head. Blink or eye movement before the scan may be helpful. Now, perhaps this is caused by a condensed vitreous opacity, or a smudge or dirty OCT lens can create the same problem. You can see it's a red disease. Now, motion artifacts are there. This is discontinuity in the blood vessels seen in the ENFES image, and eye movement during scan acquisition, particularly important within the RNFL, ONH, or RFL scan circle. Blink artifact is also there. Horizontal or vertical bars that blink during the scan. Now, here the first one is due to motion artifact. You can see the discontinuity of the blood vessels. And next is the blink. One is the vertical, horizontal blink, and the next one is the vertical blink. High myopia can mimic glaucometer structural change and confound the reference database. A posterior staphyloma can make it difficult to simultaneously capture the base of the cup and the peripapillary retina in 2 millimeter deep acquisition window, leading to image truncation. Next is the RNFL bundles may be shifted temporally, decentering the peak. The scan circle is imaged farther from the optic nerve head, and it gives you thinner RNFL. So macular scan may be more helpful in highly myopic eyes. Now, atypical anatomy and concurrent non-glaucometer disease can mask and is to confound the reference database. Number one is a split RNFL. Now, the deviation map shows a pseudo defect due to the superior temporal RNFL bundle being split rather than single. You can see here that thickness map. In thickness map, frankly speaking, there is no defect, but you can find out the split RNFL bundle. Next is the epiretinal membrane, the most common confounding disease for both RNFL and macular scar. Look for this spoke-like irregularity on the GC-IPL thickness map. This is again that example of split bundle defect. And you can see here that you have to differentiate from deviation map and the thickness map. So distinguish anatomical variation and artifacts from true glaucometer's damage. Here you can see in the both right and left eye, large vitreous floaters. Right eye is more than the left eye. And it obscured, I mean, you can see it also in the deviation map also. So it influenced the RNFL thickness measurement. In the both the cases, we can see RNFL quadrant and RNFL clock hours inferior defect. Now, in the left eye, if you see, is the irregular shape of the optic nerve. And the discontinuity of the blood vessels, we can see in the deviation map. So that it indicates a motion artifact. Again, it is an example of red disease patients. This is the error of the, here is the vitreous floaters and vitreous condensation. You can see here inaccurate segmentation of inferior RNFL tissue. Now, red disease can happen due to segmentation error. Already we have mentioned segmentation error are common, particularly with poor signal strength, disease, and high myopia. Watch for atypical result, dramatic sector differences. Careful inspect each scan for segmentation accuracy. This is a case of red disease due to segmentation error. Another example of segmentation error, you can follow here two lines, that is purple line and the yellow line. Both the inner and outer layer miss identification. If you just follow the purple line, you can see that it doesn't follow the contour of inner ganglion cell layer, and the yellow line does not follow the outer inner plexiform layer. So it is a problem of segmentation problem. Mirror artifacts, this is image folds on itself, and it the machine is unable to distinguish between negative and positive time delay, and hence produce images around the zero time delay line, which are usually mirrored image. So you can see here the real image and also the mirrored image. So segmental problem can happen also in healthy retinal imaging, epiretinal membrane, vitreomacular traction, macular hole, pigment epithelial detachment, central serous chorioretinopathy, age-related macular degeneration, cystoid macular edema, and geography atrophy. This is one example of green disease. Here we have seen that the RNFL deviation map is normal. Both the cases is normal, and optic nerve gate and RNFL summary table, if you just follow the both, they are, quadrant and clock hour analysis, all are green. Here you can see some white also. But if you see the thickness map above, you can see definitely the RNFL TS thickness map and also the RNFL TSNIT profile, where I put my arrow. Here you can see the superior RNFL is definitely thinner than the inferior one in right eye. So here it is, right eye is down. And here the asymmetry is early asymmetry. This is very characteristics of early glaucoma, but we all looks green. So it is not, identified by OCT. Now, if we see the disc here, so slightly thin superior rim, I don't see it is slightly, it is, you can differentiate it, definitely it is thinner in the superior one. And a small disc hemorrhage is also there in the superior limb, in the right eye. Now, in addition, there was a corresponding inferior nasal step here, you can see. And so this is a right eye is glaucomatous and OCT cannot differentiate it. IOP, while in the statistically normal range, it may be a case of normal tension glaucoma, and it is consistently 3 to 4 millimeter higher in the right eye from the left eye in each visit. So this is an example of green disease. Now, out of register artifact, this is shifting of the scan superiorly, you can see, with loss of information of temporal area. Now, off center artifact, I have already mentioned, when the central fovea is displaced over 0.25 millimeter, from its real location in ETDRS map. Next is the foveal duplication. Red arrow shows the real location of fovea, and the pink arrow shows here the duplicated fovea in optical coherence map and related B scan. I just want to mention about floor effect. Compared to early and moderate glaucoma, OCT is less useful in advanced cases. In advanced glaucoma, only the retinal vascular structures and glial cells remain due to RNFL loss. In other words, glaucoma progression analysis with OCT is no longer possible at this stage, and visual field should be the focus during follow-up. In the OCT device currently in use, RNFL thickness less than 30 mu micron cannot be obtained even in a small area. If a lower RNFL thickness measurement observed, the physician should carefully examine the scan for artifacts. So to conclude, diagnosis should not be based on a single test result or a region scan. One must bear in mind that the artifact may be present in every test. Therefore, important decision regarding treatment and follow-up should not be based on a single report or a single region scan. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tutul. Dr. Manish, your comment on this.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. I think I'm meeting Tutul Madam after a long time, maybe virtually only. So nice to meet you, Madam. So Madam has nicely covered almost everything. Nothing much to add. A very important point she has mentioned, that if you see a thickness of less than 30 or less than 40 micron, it should raise a suspicion, because nowhere, because of the residual non-neural tissue and glial tissue, RNFL thickness can never go below 40 micron. And one problem I've seen with OCT is that it creates more confusion than it helps you actually. Because especially when you have purchased a high-end machine, a 50 lakh machine or a Spectralase of a 1 crore machine, you think now you can diagnose everything. You just do OCT and now your diagnosis will come in a report with all. Now you are so much engrossed looking at those red areas. Before you see those red zones, first see the centration, see the scans, signal strength, see the motion artifact and segment. Because if you start seeing them, you will see almost 50% of OCT will have some artifact here and there. In fact, there was a study by Dr. Asrani where they use spectral domain OCT. And there also they have shown that almost 40% of their patient had artifact. So be very, very careful in diagnosing a patient based on OCT. Your clinical evaluation and visual field still are better. OCT can be a supplement, but not the deciding factor for glaucoma diagnosis.
Thank you, Dr. Sumita ma'am. Now you are the most experienced person and we have done almost everything, all the gadgets involved, what are the common errors. Can you say something about the IC or this GV?
All the speakers have covered everything. There is nothing left for me to tell. Only our students will actually follow these tips. That is the most important thing.
Dr. Rita, ma'am. Dr. Rita Das. Ma'am, unmute yourself. Rita, ma'am.
Unmute yourself.
Sir, everything is very nicely covered. One thing is that I'm quadrantinopia, usually neurological, usually it points towards the blind spot. And in glaucoma, it usually points towards the fixation. That is a point for students we can leave.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
So I think we finished our session and talk on time. All coordinator, Prasad.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Deepak ji. It was really nice to see you. And thank you so much for finishing it and keeping it on time.